Hunts Point Road Extension, down into the drainage swale, the new ditch that you propose running from Jordan Farm Road to the corner of the property. If you can identify where I'm talking about, Scott.
Say that again.
It's that east-west thing that we were talking about last time, right in there.
Right in there.
Yep. Could you tell us, and it was a little unclear for laymen sitting on the board, the culvert that goes underneath that road, what elevation that is, and the ditch that comes out of that culvert, how that's going to be configured and what it will look like?
Well, there'll be a field inlet catch basin that would collect any water that's in this area, would carry it into the underground storm drain system, would bring it down to be discharged into this drainage ditch that would be constructed along this property line here within that 30-foot right-of-way. And the water would discharge to this ditch, flow over to the existing drainage ditch, and down under Jordan Farm Road.
What would the characteristics of that ditch and ditching system be? I know you have a detail that shows a 2-foot wide bottom, a 3-to-1 slope coming out of it. How much of a cut will the existing ground be required at that point?
Off the top of my head, without going back to the drawing stick, I don't know. It's, you know, 3 or 4 feet probably anyway.
What's the bottom of the culvert as it comes underneath the road?
The invert?
Yes.
Off the top of my head, I don't know. I can dig out the drawings here and check it for you.
I'm interested. It appears to me, and you might want to just comment on this, that the culvert is at, the invert is at about 75 and a half feet. And it appears as though there's some contours, existing contours of land that are at about 80 feet coming out of that. So it would appear that you would have a 4 to 5 foot cut existing down through there.
That's correct.
So you'll be using
4 and a half foot cut.
Okay. You'll be using the entire 30 feet then for that ditch, presumably.
Much of it, yes.
29, 30 feet of the 30 foot ditch.
That's correct.
Okay. The existing ditch that then runs into, there are no details on it, and it only shows being dug as necessary or sculpted as necessary to take the water flow. How did the new formed ditch, which goes east to west, meld with the existing drainage ditch? Is it field condition type of?
Yes, it would be.
Of digging and then sculpting?
That's right.
Okay.
And although the drawings at this point don't indicate it, there would be some riprap installed at that junction of the two ditches, certainly, to prevent erosion.
And in my own review, I was wondering if that's what it was really going to look like, and it appeared to from the detailed drawings that you had. There's a lot of concern for water flow in the back of the houses off Hunts Point Road Extension. And in walking the site on Saturday before, in fact, all of the rain on Sunday, there was a lot of water in that whole area. So what you're proposing at least is to open up the outlet system for that water flow, allowing it to flow. And there appear to be a number of lawns that have extended into the wetland area by owners on Hunts Point Extension. But your sculpting, your engineering of that end appears to then be able to handle a lot of water that could be flowing out of that. Would you comment
correct.
On that?
That's accurate.
Is that the reason for it being that big?
Well, partly the reason, but also the depth requires that we utilize a lot of that right-of-way for the construction of the ditch per the details that we've included.
Okay. Next question maybe is Mr. Kennedy's. The area on Lot 6, I believe it is south, we had requested that you consider donating that an entire strip of land along the southern portion to some agency, Conservation Commission or some other group. You've indicated the Land Trust. And you had indicated that you wanted to reserve a spot of land down there for a possible leach field. Your plans also indicate that that's an area for possible building location or building setback lines, a building envelope. Do you want to comment on how you propose to use that land and why?
This is not meant to show a building envelope, more as to buffer wetlands and property line. I think this dotted line is keyed to the buffer, but Scott could correct me if I'm wrong. The building site for this lot is here. The septic system is up here. This is one of the two-bedroom, it's one of the four two-bedroom sites. There is a good test hole right in this location. I'd like to keep that as a possible future septic site, since the soils are limited on this fairly large lot.
Okay, I'll express one concern as a planning board member, and that is that that septic site would be 400 or 500 or 600 feet away from your proposed building location. That's a difficult run for a septic system to be that far away and out of the sight of the homeowner. I will propose later that if this board moves to adopt the or to approve the plan, that that be limited to no building and no septic systems, unless it were a difference at some point in time where you came back to the planning board and requested that to be used for a septic system. I guess I'm very concerned that with a pond that exists there, the extent of wetlands that exist on three sides of your septic system area, that it's, notwithstanding what your test pit may show, a difficult and perhaps an inappropriate location for a septic system. So we'll see what happens with the board. And I really wanted your comments on how you propose to use that
site.
Well,
I'd really like to tie into the sewer here. I'm not allowed to.
You understand there is an issue that is generic to all developments in Cape Elizabeth before the town council that has been broached by the planning board. And that is to wherever there are sites that are approvable for on-site wastewater disposal, to allow the planning board the option of granting or allowing public sewer hookup wherever there's capacity determined by the public works director and wherever it's appropriate in the planning board's view. That has not been passed as ordinance in this town. It will be presented to the town council. It has been presented to the sewer board, and they've unanimously endorsed the concept. The idea is not to increase density within the community, but to take those projects that are approvable with on-site wastewater disposal and to allow public sewer hookups for those units, not increasing the density or intensity of land use in the community, but ensuring that future on-site waste disposal isn't a problem. That would presumably be as appropriate in your project as it is a number of others in the community. But that's an unknown at this point, and that does require town council action. There is an issue, too, of an emergency public access road that has followed this project from its inception to perhaps its end. Depending on what the planning board wishes to do with this application this evening, there is a motion before you that has been crafted that we can talk about later, but which essentially says to the town council that if this development were approved, then this planning board would recommend very strongly to the town council that be a portion of the Jordan Farm Road be allowed only for emergency access, as was suggested by one of the neighbors at an earlier public meeting. That is appropriate for town council action, not for planning board action, because that is it's under the traffic ordinances of the community, which the planning board does not enforce, but the council does. So there are issues there that will not affect or impact your proposed development, and that's an issue internally for the town to decide how to most appropriately use that road. And that is at least the suggestion that the planning board would be making. One other issue that I had, and I'm sure there are others that other board members wish to raise this evening, your last submission to the town and your testimony by your engineers indicated that there's a 15-foot no-clearing area along every boundary line, And yet I didn't see how that will be enforced by you as the applicant who proposes the subdivision, and then how we're left with that 5 or 10 years down the road. So if you'd care to comment on how you propose to protect that 15-foot no clearing line on every property line in the subdivision, I'd appreciate it.
Well, what we've done in the past and other developments is put a covenant in each deed that site planning, number one, has to be approved by us, and number two, that each covenant is enforceable by any other neighbor. Therefore, if someone cuts on a line, another neighbor can come along and say, hey, you violated this covenant. So you have almost a double police action. We don't necessarily leave it up to the town, but it's worked very well in Bath. It's worked well in Portland.
What are the penalties for someone who does that?
Counselor?
Paul Frensko, Mr. Chairman. I think what you'll see in this proposal in its final form, it will be a covenant on the plan to be recorded, and that will give notice to all lot owners. In addition, there'll be a covenant in the deed, so everyone will be on notice. The penalty not being enforceable by the town, unless there is a town ordinance that would prohibit clearing, at which time there would be penalties both in terms of civil monetary penalties and restoration requirements. But the penalty in a private enforcement action is both a cease to the activities and a restoration of what has been done in violation of the covenant.
Concern is 10 years away. The development, if it were approved, is built out. The applicant has maybe kept one of the houses and is a neighbor in Cape Elizabeth, but presumably not, and typically not. And someone clear cuts right up to their property line. The abutting landowners complain about that, go to that owner, and words are exchanged and hard feelings are developed. But on what basis does an adjacent neighbor force the replanting of that cleared strip?
All right. Now, I guess the question I have to ask you, Mr. Tinsman, when you say adjacent, do you mean someone outside of the development?
Doesn't matter where it is.
If someone who has purchased one of these lots by reference to this recorded plan is not only bound by the covenants which appear on that plan, but also has the right to enforce the covenants which appear on that plan. That would be the private enforcement mechanism. To the extent that this particular subdivision has been approved by the planning board with those covenants, then those covenants become a condition of the planning board's approval. Planning board would have the authority under existing law to enforce those covenants, but I will leave that to an internal discussion with your attorney, not go further than that.
What is the
I don't know what your practice is in this town.
I understand from a planning board process, and there are too many house lots in the town for the planning board or its code enforcement people
Typical.
To be there every day. It's more likely to be a private landowner who is a part of the subdivision who may have some rights to go back to someone who does clear cut to their line. And I guess what I'm asking is, what is the remedy, what is the fix for someone who disregards what could be an important item for this planning board to consider in its deliberative process on whether to approve or deny the application? And I guess I'm asking, what is the
private
fix?
Remedy is to cease what has been started.
Through court action and join?
Unfortunately, yes. And an order of restoration, since that would be a violation, and the court, using its equitable powers, could require the landowner to restore the land to the state that it was in prior to the unlawful activity, with the goal in mind of eventually having the land that was cut in violation of the covenant naturally restore itself to what it was before. And I offer this latter comment only because our experience in enforcing clear-cutting violations through the expert testimony of foresters, that you really cannot immediately replace a 40 or 50 foot tree. What you have to do is come in with appropriate plantings that will are able to be transplanted and supported and nurtured and planted properly in a fashion that they will eventually restore the area to what it looked in the shortest possible time.
Can you comment on the importance of those 15-foot or 30-foot strips of land between every boundary for the record and for the future?
Well, they're important in that they are a representation by this developer that they will be left, and we understand that they are not only important to the integrity of the development internally, but they obviously are important to those who live adjacent, and they are a representation. They will be both on the plan and in the deed restriction, and if I knew of a more creative or more or a less administratively burdensome way to enforce them, we would give it to you, but we haven't been able to think of one in the time that I've been in practice.
Okay. Thank you very much. Other members of the board?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Most.
If this is the appropriate time to ask Mr. Hunter maybe to come up, I've got some questions of a traffic nature. Maybe we can get to the question of the drainage also.
Welcome, Mr. Hunter.
Welcome.
It's good to see you again.
My name is Robert Hunter. I am serving as the town engineer in review of this project.
And you wished it was a little bit earlier in the evening, as do we.
Well, I go to a number of planning board meetings.
Mr. Most.
Yes, Mr. Hunter. Question on Hunts Point Road extension. In your letter dated May 10th, you alluded to item number 10, which I believe was the traffic flow diversion that was originally offered as a possible way of limiting the flow of traffic down Hunts Point Road. And your summary was it's not feasible and could create a hazardous condition. If this is the same diversion I'm thinking of, it was a diversion that allowed the traffic to move down Hunts Point Road and into the new section, leaving the bottom part of Hunts Point Road a little bit less obviously traveled. Could you give us some idea as to why that was considered not feasible and it could not be done as a good design?
Okay. It should be understood, I am not a traffic engineer by profession, and that came to our office and it was reviewed by our traffic department. And basically the problem we have is that Hunts Point Road extension is only a 40-foot right-of-way, which I think is the last one of those, hopefully, we have in the town. And in order to try to put the island or the diversion device within the existing right-of-way that you had, it was the opinion of our traffic engineers that that was not going to function to do what you wanted it to do, and also it was going to create, in their opinion, an increased safety hazard because of confusion of the traffic as to what's going to happen at that particular spot. And they made a very strong recommendation that that not be installed, that it would probably increase the safety hazards rather than decreasing them. Now, I think in the last submission, there was a sketch that was put forth by the developer which showed a much more expansive type of design for that intersection, which was the same basic concept, but it was expanded in order to give much better traffic lane definition. And our review of that indicated that, that would work, that would serve the purpose that you would like to have. However, obviously, it is not practical at that intersection at this time because of the extensive additional land and right-of-way that would be required. So I think that, as I say, the expanded one would work if you had the right-of-way, but we feel fairly strongly that the trying to do it within the existing right-of-ways would not be satisfactory. And I think that the developers traffic engineer, once he had looked at that, also concurred that that would not be an effective way to slow the traffic.
Were there any other ideas that could be put forward to accomplish the same end, or is this just not?
No, we couldn't come up with any ideas or anything significant that you could do within the rights of way that were there. Unfortunately, with Hunts Point Road, you have a long, very straight roadway, which does encourage increased speed as you go on. One of the things we have done in other developments is to come down and periodically in long stretches like this put a cul-de-sac with plantings in the middle of it, so when people approach they feel they are coming to the end of the road, they slow down and go around, and then they decide, yes, we can go on. But again, here with all of the lots already sold on Hunts Point Road, you simply can't do that within the rights of way that you have. So I'm afraid that when the extension of Hunts Point Road was approved and the lots were sold and built, basically you confined yourself in that basically precludes anything that's really going to meet the purpose that you want.
Thank you.
While Mr. Hunter's there, perhaps you could address the issue of and your recommendation for the stormwater runoff on Pine Ridge Road adjacent properties, particularly.
Okay. One of the questions that Mr. Butler posed to me in looking at this was the question of the stormwater runoff from the easterly portion of the site at the end of Channel View Road. And there are three or four lots that are proposed in there. And as explained by the developer's engineer, I think that we should understand that whenever you're going to alter a land surface or you're going to modify what's there, you indeed are going to change the runoff characteristics of the property. In this case, what we're doing is increasing the impervious surface of the area by building a short section of paved roadway. There are, I think, three houses that would be within that drainage area and the driveways that are tributary to it. We reviewed their drainage report and calculations, and we would also concur that with the low density and the minor changes that are involved in there, that the change in peak runoff is so limited that you can't define it by the normal analytical program that you would have for this type of watershed. The particular property, I think, that was in question was the last two lots on Pine Ridge Road, which have been constructed on. I think, as you can see from this plan, that all of the runoff from this area basically wanders down and goes into a wetland area, and that wetland area basically continues across the property and is really a part of the larger contiguous wetland that is down in here, although it doesn't show on the plan. Now, I think the biggest alteration that happened to this wetland was done many years ago when Pine Ridge Road was constructed down to here, but in fact the fill and the grading and gravel were placed for the future construction of Pine Ridge Road. When that happened, we basically cut this wetland in half. We have the southerly section here and the northerly section that connected with the main wetland and the brook that goes through Broad Cove. This was kind of cut in two. And the drainage outlet of this area then, rather than being diffused through the wetlands down to the brook, was concentrated and enters into a piped system at the intersection of Roundabout Lane and is piped down to the brook. So what has happened with that? We basically are concentrating most of the water in this section of the wetland here. We are diverting it, and we are letting less water go in to this wetland down here. So I think the major alteration to the wetland occurred when that was built. I think by developing the low intensity here, while theoretically I say yes, there is going to be a slight increase in runoff. It is not going to be perceptible. And I think with the major wetland area that's there, that the impacts on the adjacent properties are not going to be significant. I would note that the outbuilding on this lot here appears to have been built in an area that was filled into the wetland at some time. And obviously when you do that, the area generally is going to be wet in its natural condition. So my evaluation would be that rather than having the drainage right-of-way adjacent to the property line, as was proposed on the original plan, which is not in harmony with the actual contours of the land, that the location be changed and the water from the roadway be diverted directly into the wetland area so it can be, it'll be absorbed into the wetland and the peak flows will be cut down. I think that can be done without any impact on the proposal for the lot. I guess it's probably not a concern of the particular developer, but I think in order to get this wetland back to its more normal state, it might be desirable to consider putting multiple channels or culverts through the old fill that was in Pine Ridge Road to allow the drainage to diffuse through the wetlands the way it did before Pine Ridge Road was built, rather than being piped around the area at this time. But again, that's not really related to this project. It's an observation of what might be improved or what happened in the past.
Mr. Hunter, as our town engineer and as recommending to the planning board the changes to the proposed applicant's plans, mm-hmm. you've proposed the best fix that you can see to ameliorate any concerns for stormwater runoff onto adjacent properties in Pine Ridge Road.
Yes, I think so. As I say, within the context of the very light development that's taking place in here, we're talking about three roofs, a very short section of paved drive, and the land alteration is going to be very minimal. I think trying to build or put in detention facilities to try to cut down flows of that very minor magnitude would not be effective. I think the most effective protection you have is the maintenance of the wetland area that you have here, and again, that's one of the primary goals or the benefits you receive by maintaining the wetland is they are very effective in cutting the peak flows down.
You've also made just now a recommendation for town, potentially town action on Pine Ridge Road to the planning board so that it doesn't get lost here this evening on May 15th. If it's appropriate, you might make that same recommendation to the Public Works Director in a form of a letter or a meeting to him so that as part of his Public Works budget, he can review that and implement it if it's an appropriate action.
I'd be glad to do so.
Mr. Most, you have the floor. Any further questions?
Yeah, just one minor one. We've heard some discussion of the buffering on the lot that is on the corner of, I guess it's Jordan Farm Road now? And yes. Where we move that road over as far as it can go, and it only accounts for 3 or 4 feet, I guess, movement.
That's right.
The way the buffering is now planned, is this going to be allow for a shielding of road traffic from that house, or is it still going to be fairly ineffective?
Well, I think that I can only comment on the roadway construction or the geometrics on it, and the developer has tried to offset the center line and push the traveled way away from the house to the extent that you can. Unfortunately, with the slide slopes and the configuration of the area, I think 2 to 3 feet or something is about the only effective thing you can do and keep within the right-of-way that you have, and I think he has tried to move it to the extent that he could. Now, not being a landscape architect, I really don't feel I'm qualified to comment on whether the plantings or the buffering is going to be that effective. I suspect a lot of that is in the eyes of the beholder as to what's adequate and what isn't, and I don't think I can comment on that.
Okay. I'm all set. Thanks.
Okay. Before we go on with other questions, it is 10 of 10. We have two other applications before us tonight, Century 21 Balfour for an extension of time for a previously approved site plan, and a pre-application conference for Viking Intermediate Care Facility. Rather than get till 10:15, 10:30, and then decide not to extend for new items, let me ask before we approach that time whether it's the intent of the Planning Board to allow Mr. Balfour and Viking Intermediate Care Facility to present their applications this evening.
Mr. Chairman? It would be my feeling that we should indicate to those people that we probably will not get to those items tonight. I really think that this issue is going to take up some time, and I don't think it's really fair to keep people waiting around for that length of time.
Okay. My comment on Mr. Balfour that he does have a time, and it will only take a couple of minutes. The Viking Intermediate Care Facility, for a pre-application conference. They've been waiting for some time to come before the board. It appears as though we are going to be late this evening. Probably wouldn't do anybody any good to start something at 11 o'clock for the first time. What is the board's feelings on taking a half an hour at the June 5th workshop meeting after the Ed Drinan project? And ask the Viking Intermediate to present half an hour then. Okay. So that you might
right.
go...
Yeah. Hmm? Yeah, I think that'd be okay.
Okay. So that you might not have to wait around until 11 o'clock to find then that we're not going to listen for the pre-application conference. We would ask you to come to our June 5th meeting at 8:30 in the cafeteria downstairs. It'll be a workshop session, and we'd like to hear the pre-application conference at that time. So you're free to go this evening. And thank you for coming. Okay, continuing back. Mr. Mosh, you've completed
Excuse
your
me,
questions.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
Did we resolve the Balfour issue?
I would like to see us perhaps deal with it. I don't think it will take too long. There are simple questions of extension of time. And if Mr. Balfour is willing to wait till 11 or 12, then we'll talk.
I suggest we take this on an hourly basis.
Okay. Very good. Mr. Mosh, you've relinquished. Mr.
Yes.
Balfour, you are going to stay. Other questions or comments? Mr. Emery.
Being fairly new to the process, I believe there's a real benefit of having been involved as long as you, Dick, and other Mr. Chairman and other members of the committee have. I would just like to, from a somewhat of an outside perspective, offer a couple of comments that I see here before us that I think are indicative of a number of subdivisions and will continually bring neighbors either primarily against projects, and that is the use of very narrow rights of way to gain access to very large parcels of land that created a tremendous uproar in the city of South Portland. And I think that may be, to a certain extent, the crux of what's before us. In terms of completeness in the work that the applicant has put before us, at least in my experience, this is quite an energetic parcel. So from that standpoint, I feel fairly confident that it's substantially complete. When I look at the texture of this proposal relative to the adjacent development, my general impression is that one of the main issues here is that we're dealing with a camel, that this development is the straw, which perhaps is breaking the camel's back, but I'd also like to say at the same time, my observations in the area, is this camel has been eating a lot of straw over the last 20 years. I look at the size of the lots adjacent to the property. I look to the dedicated open space of those adjacent parcels. And I think in comparison to that, in comparison to the requirements of the zoning, the applicant has done a reasonable job in terms of providing open space and providing lots significantly larger than what is adjacent to the property. In terms of access to Two Lights Road, I've heard a number of arguments pro and con on that, primarily the issue of safety. In terms of a logical development layout, I don't think there's anything particularly beneficial in terms of lotting of the plan other than second means of access or emergency access to Hunts Point Road Extension. And I have one additional question. That would be the Two Lights Road, the building that's fronting on Two Lights Road. Is the intention to remove that road building entirely?
The intention is to preserve the building, the farmhouse, and the barn, and what is called the squash barn, and just tear down the garage and the chicken coop in back of it.
I have one other question on the HHE 200 forms. I believe each form has a layout of the septic system, but I didn't see anything, and it's done for each lot. I didn't see anything that tied that location of that septic system down to the lot. Am I missing something in that, or?
On page 3?
Yes.
We have that now. One of our problems was that, as was reported by our soils engineer, that all our controls in the field were either removed, obliterated, or actually moved on the site to another location in the same pattern that they were in. So we had to start from scratch. And we do have now all the applications and, all the elevations tied into each design system.
What are the locations based on that we have before us?
The test pits on the 40 scale and the, I think it's only on the 40 scale, correct? On the 40 scale drawings.
And what in the case where there's a number of test pits with any individual lot, which test pit is? Is that within the document? Does it state that it's four
yes.
test pits?
Yes.
Okay. One other question. In terms of the proposed house location, is that simply to demonstrate where a house can go on the lot, or is it your intention that the houses would be placed within a reasonable proximity to that location?
Within a reasonable proximity within the building envelope.
Thank you.
Other questions or comments?
Mr. Chairman. Staying with the soils evaluation issue, lot number one on phase two, you have two test pits shown. All the other sites simply have one, which you're basing your testing upon. Why do you choose two on that site?
Why did we show two?
Choose to. You show both the documentation and on the preliminary subdivision plan, two different test
on
pits.
Lot number one.
On lot number one, yes.
I think that was because in the original plan, lot number one, we eliminated, I think, two lots in this area. And the original HHE 200 forms as submitted, I think, in October, the dividing line went between the two test pit holes, and actually they're very good soils in that area. So I assume Steve Farah came back and picked one and put it on the form. But I'm pretty sure on that lot, if you go out there in the field today, you'll see the markings of two test pits. One, however, is marked now with paint on the ground that'll hopefully stay.
Okay. Our ordinance states that the laundry systems have to be designed on marginal soils. That's indicated by 13 of the 20 sites. Am I correct that those weren't prepared at the April 27th?
At the time of the submission, that is correct. They have been designed and separated as per the code, the state code and the local plumbing code.
Okay. Seven of the sites... also in the ordinance, it states that the four corners of the in this case, chamber systems, need to be identified with test pits and borings. Seven of those, and all seven were marginal sites. None of the information that I get, that's page 2 of 3A, don't mean to keep throwing in one more page, but it's always there, weren't, and I checked back through both of the books, the green books, and I've taken them all apart, and I put them all together, so mm-hmm. I think I have all the information. Does that coincide with your records that the marginal soils for at least seven of the lots don't have the corner test pit?
As far as I knew, when my last visitation with Steve Farah, all the lots were marked with the blue flags in the corners. But that was in January, mm-hmm. and since then, I don't think there are but one or two left.
Lot number 8 in phase 2 doesn't, the most current information done by Steve Farron doesn't coincide with the earlier test pit soils profiles. Is there a reason for that? Did they change pits and not change the reference number?
Could, if my memory serves me, the original pit for 8 was under the roadway. The roadway was switched to go around the this wetland here. So the test pit had to be moved in this location approximately over in here,
okay,
which does show on the 40 scale.
That's okay. Lot number 3 in phase 1 shows us test pit 10, which is a new test pit. I couldn't find it on any of the back older maps, and doesn't have a page 2 of 3 of the HHE 200. Is that something that just simply wasn't submitted?
He could have missed it, but he spent an awful lot of time out there. I'd have to check on that. Test pit 10, lot 3?
Yeah. Also, lot number 5, phase 1, doesn't list a test pit number, and also is missing the page 2 of 3. Does that have a lot? Does that have a test pit number? I couldn't find it on any reference map.
And there was another lot that didn't have a test pit number, lot number 5, although I thought they were...
Five of phase 1.
Okay, right. That did not have a test pit number, but it's located on the 40 scale, and it is tied to reference points by Steve Farron.
Okay, I'll look at it. I guess the key reason, and I keep going back to this, is I don't really have... I have a lot of concerns about the entire site. I feel at ease about some of them. The septic issue continuously haunts me. 7 of the sites, the chamber system, or the chamber bed leach field, is within 50 feet of what's designated as wetlands. I'm not a soils evaluator. I have a real strong concern for detrimental effect in the wetlands. We're looking at 6 out of those 7 sites have soils depths of 17 to 18 inches to an impervious level. I guess, you know, I still look at this, I look at it very closely, mainly because I understand soils evaluation. Again, I'm not a soils evaluator, but I understand it, and they keep coming up short. I think the key sites that I have a hard time with are lot 13, 14, 1, and 5. I guess some of this I'll just quickly have to review.
One?
One in phase 2.
In phase 2.
Yeah, not one phase 1.
Right. 13 is a two-bedroom site. I can understand your concern there. One has excellent soils. And what was your other... 5.
Okay.
5 is another two-bedroom. 5 south is two-bedroom.
My problem with lot number 1 is that while it has reasonable soils, it's still close to a wetland that drains into a massive wetland area through abutting property areas. I fully realize that these are designed to take on the flow of sewage effluent. I'm also looking at just those 7 sites, about 750,000 gallons of effluent per year pumps into those chamber systems. That's a lot of effluent, especially when they're as close to wetlands as are. My understanding is that we have a nitrate study
yes,
by your group that says
yes,
it won't affect the budding properties past the boundaries. We have another study that says that it may, and my understanding is that the DEP still has not finished their report. Is that right?
The DEP has not finished. That's correct. And C.B. Mahar will be reporting directly to DEP.
I guess at this time I don't have any questions, further questions.
Thank you, Steve. Any other questions or comments by board members?
Just a point of clarification. Tom. There's a note on well, the second sheet, first sheet in the set, it says 25-foot existing right-of-way for pedestrian traffic. It says existing. Is it one to assume that that's to remain as part of the development?
Yes, I believe. Is that that this one here that runs through the site?
Yes.
Yes, that will remain.
I think to in order to have it clear to everyone, I think it would be important to add a note that, that states that that, in fact, is the case, that the intention is that that will remain.
Mr. Chairman, just to clarify, the right-of-way would just be for the few people that have rights.
Have the rights to it. We have the rights. Well, it's maybe Paul could comment. There are certain people that have the rights to that right-of-way that are specified in their deeds. We are not going to do anything to take away that right. So that right-of-way will stay on the plan and actually goes through a portion of some lots.
So what you're saying is you're not offering that. That's something that exists on the land right now.
I can't offer it.
You're just reflecting it.
I can't offer it. It's not mine to offer.
I know. I know. I'm making a comment.
Okay.
Any other comments by planning board members? Janet.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to understand a little bit about the pedestrian easements in the northern section of the property. You reviewed the new pedestrian access in the southern portion. You'd also mentioned something in your submissions about the open space and recreation areas, and in particular mentioned a two-acre field that was high and dry, and I'd like to know where that is.
That's right in this area here.
Uh-huh. And how about the pedestrian easements in the northern section?
The pedestrian easement on the north side begins at Broad Cove Road, comes down to the intersection of Pine Ridge Road here at this corner, and goes along the top of lots 2, 3, then between lots 3 and 4 onto the roadway. Then there's another pedestrian walkway path system that will come at the end of Hunts Point Road up to this lot, and then it then I've got a problem we've been discussing is that I only have certain rights to go out to Lights Road. And there are other people that have those same rights.
Other questions or comments, board members? What are the wishes of the board?
Mr. Chairman, we're considering preliminary plan approval first, is that right? Is this the order, or are we doing the wetlands?
Steve has prepared the wetlands alteration first, but it can be in either order.
Okay.
Depending on the board members. The actions the board can take are to approve the conditions, or to deny this evening.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes?
Is there any opportunity at this time? Obviously, we have a number of neighbors that haven't had an opportunity to comment since these considerable changes have been put forth.
No, I'm sorry, there isn't. The public hearing has been closed, and there is no further public hearing. It's a question of whether they're major changes or not. I'll leave that to your own interpretation. This board has not called for another public hearing, and there will be not.
There were major changes requested by this board at the last time this was reviewed. Certainly, whether they were made or not, they were requested by the board.
Thank you very much.
May I make a clarification point here?
Sure.
The planning board does not make up the rules that it operates under. I think the public should understand that. We operate under ordinances that are enacted by the town council. And we are empowered to enforce those ordinances, and that's all we can do. If the town has a problem with the ordinances and the way that the planning board conducts its business, the action has to be taken through the town council.
Well, many times precedent has been set at this board in the past to
Let me indicate again that the public hearing has been closed, that this is an action by the board tonight. The time for public comment has been closed, and you're out of order. The board's action, whichever it prefers to make a motion this evening.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion. Be it ordered, and I'll try to read the entire. I think it's important to get the entire motion read into the record, so I will go through it. Be it ordered that the planning board finds that the applicant has generally met the standards contained in this.
Is your microphone on?
Should be. Okay, let me get up a little closer. Be it ordered that the planning board finds that the applicant has generally met the standards contained in the subdivision ordinance and therefore approves the preliminary plan. Subdivision plan of the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot subdivision proposed by the Greater Portland Development Group in accordance with Section 16-1-1, 16-2-4, and Article 3 of the Subdivision Ordinance and the facts presented subject to the following conditions. And there are A through I conditions, and I'll read them at this point. A, that all lands proposed for Cape Elizabeth Land Trust ownership shall be accepted by the Cape Elizabeth Land Trust, and that written proof of said acceptance shall be provided prior to the submission of the final plan. B, that the pedestrian easement crossing the southern portion of the site be situated in a manner allowing for pedestrian access that does not intrude on the identified endangered or threatened plants, and that is passable by pedestrians on a year-round basis. Said pedestrian easement shall be in a form and location acceptable to the town planner. C, that all pedestrian easements shall be clearly identified on the final plan and that the legal documentation and all other arrangements concerning the dedication of the pedestrian easements to the town of Cape Elizabeth shall be prepared by the applicant and reviewed by the town attorney and the town manager for legal sufficiency prior to the submission of the final plan. D, that all proposed lots shall have building envelopes designated on the final plan that adequately indicate the land area within which any development activity will be permitted. E, that all the necessary legal documentation relating to any activities permitted or prohibited inside and outside the building envelope shall also be prepared by the applicant and deemed acceptable by the town attorney and the town planner prior to the submission of the final plan. These restrictions shall be placed in the final subdivision plan and within the deeds of each of the proposed lots, the language of which shall be reviewed and deemed acceptable by the town attorney prior to the submission of the final plan. F, that the building envelope on the southeastern portion of lot 6S be eliminated in order to ensure that no residential construction or septic system construction shall occur in close proximity to the existing wetland areas. G, that the applicant will meet with the public works director, police chief, fire chief, town planner, and town manager to discuss the town staff's recommendation regarding stop and sign placement on Hunts Point Road, Farm Pond Road, Coveview Road, and Two Lights Road, and that the applicant will add said improvements to the set plan prior to the submission of the final plan. H, that the applicant indicates with detailed drawings that the driveway serving lots numbers 5S, 6S, 1 North, 2 North, 3 North, 7 North, 11 North, 12 North, and 3 North can meet the public access waiver standards of Section 19-4-2B of the Zoning Ordinance as required by subsection 16-3-1, parentheses 1, and that the proposed public access waiver roadways shall be deemed acceptable by the fire chief and the town planner prior to the submission of the final plan. And finally, I, that the post-development drainage system in the vicinity of Pine Ridge Road will be redesigned by the applicant's engineer so that there will be no net increase in runoff on adjacent properties, with these results being submitted for review and acceptance by the town engineer prior to the submission of a final plan. This is according to subsection 16-3-1I.
Mr. Most, Mr. Butler has an additional one that resulted from the Public Works Director's concern for the design of the entrance onto Two Lights Road, and if he may read that. And
he may read that added as item J.
That the applicant shall meet with the town planner, the public works director, and other appropriate town staff to review the Farm Pond Road, Two Lights Road intersections design, and shall make all recommended revisions to this final subdivision plan prior to the submission of the final plan. Period.
Okay.
You've heard the motion.
That's it.
Okay. You've heard the motion.
Mr. Chairman, can any questions be asked after the second?
Yes. By the board.
Yes.
Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second the motion.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
I have a question, Mr. Chairman. In Part D of the motion, it states that all proposed lots shall have building envelopes designated on the final plan that adequately indicate the land area within which any development activity will be permitted. Does that include the septic system and chamber system area?
Yes.
It does?
Yes.
Okay.
Or if you want to clarify that point, that's something that on the record. You
know. If any development activity is all inclusive of chamber systems and septic systems, septic tanks.
So that does exclude septic systems, or does it?
No, I'd say it would include septic systems.
Within the buffer zone area? Outside the... I'm not clear. I've got a...
Well, we have two different issues. We have buffer area and building window or building envelope.
Right.
Are those two different?
I think on the plans, the applicant's proposing that the two go together, that on the building envelope, that the boundary should include both the minimum setback lines, where that's appropriate, mm-hmm. but also any buffers that might also be added on to protect wetlands and other such natural features.
My question arose from the fact that a number of the chamber systems are located in the buffer area. That's a statement, I guess, not a question.
Other questions or comments?
Just a point of clarification. When you say building envelopes, you mean the actual setback boundaries of the lot, not the drawings that indicate a possible building location that has, in essence, a building envelope, which is the outside of the house.
Correct. I've been looking at the subdivision plans as with the house, you know, the darkening house spot as being illustrative, and then I heard the applicant state that house location can move anywhere within the envelope. So,
all right.
If there are any areas where the board wants to change that, that's, you know, now or during the final plan, that should be done.
No, it's fine the way it is.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? Hearing none, I'll call a question. The motion has been made and seconded as read. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Opposed? The subdivision is denied. Okay. The vote on the wetland would presumably be the same way, but there should be a motion just to clarify the agenda. So a motion for the wetlands would be in order, and a vote would be in order. Care to make the motion?
I'm not voting. Can I make a motion?
No.
I didn't think so.
It would be appropriate to make the motion to clear the agenda of the issues so that appropriate actions then can exist.
Mr. Chairman, I think you can fail for lack of a motion, too.
I beg your pardon?
It can fail for lack of a motion.
It would be good to have the motion out in front of this board and the board to take action on it. So I would ask for a motion on the wetlands issue as well.
Mr. Chairman, in
yes.
that spirit, may I move, be it ordered that the planning board finds that the wetland alterations proposed for the Highlands at Broad Cove project meet the criteria of Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of the Greater Portland Development Group for a planning board permit for wetlands alteration for the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot subdivision, be granted. According to Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions, and there are three. A, that the final wetlands boundaries shall be field checked and determined by the town's wetlands consultants. When said consultants determine that the weather conditions are adequate to perform a complete wetlands boundary field check. B, that any conditions attached to preliminary or final subdivision approval shall be applicable to this planning board permit. And C, that no construction or wetland alteration activity shall occur until after final subdivision approval is granted by the planning board.
You've heard the motion. Is there a second?
Seconded.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
I have this question, Mr. Chairman.
Okay.
Just quickly checking. Though I voted negatively on the previous issue, my issues of concern were not in the wetlands alteration. I guess I don't know how to pose the question. Does it pose a problem? Does it pose an inconsistency to vote?
What I would suggest is that we take a 7.5-minute recess and that we meet with Mike to talk about the inconsistencies of any concerns that you as a board member might feel between a positive vote on wetlands alteration and a negative vote on subdivision application. So with that, the chair will declare a 10-minute recess and ask Mike to come up and let's talk for a while. That is the process. I'll call the planning board back to order.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to withdraw the motion which I just made with respect to the wetlands alteration permit.
Withdraw your second?
I withdraw my second.
Okay. That is a temporary issue, and the reason is that we've also discussed talking about the rights and duties of the planning board, and a motion is being drafted right now by Corporation Counsel for the planning board to go to executive session to discuss the rights and duties of the planning board, and that will be ready in a moment. That motion will be made. We will be going, if the vote is affirmative, to executive session to talk about some issues that are before the planning board. And we'll be coming out of executive session and likely be taking some actions, further actions on this application, either the wetlands alteration or whatever, so stick around. Scott, you thought I was kidding about 11 o'clock, didn't you?
No, I knew you weren't.
recognizes Mr. Moss.
I'd like to make a motion regarding executive session. I move that the board go into executive session to consult with legal counsel regarding the legal rights and duties of the planning board with regard to the denial of the preliminary plan, subdivision plan for the Highlands at Broad Cove.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by raising your hand. Opposed? Unanimous decision. This planning board is in executive session. And we will return and reconvene as a public body. Development Group Highlands at Broad Cove application. That motion failed for lack of vote. The item is still before this planning board. What are the wishes of the planning board?
Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Edsel.
Right. I'd like to make a motion that be it therefore ordered that the planning board finds, based on and under the standards of section 16-3-1S, and should I read each section?
Yes.
Which states, all systems proposed for the disposal of sewage for developments regulated by this ordinance shall be governed by the provisions of Chapter 15 of Sewer Ordinance, wherein the purpose of Article 1, section 16-1-1A, which reads, will not result in undue water or air pollution. In making this determination, it shall consider at least the elevation of the land above sea level, its relation to the floodplains, the nature of the soils and subsoils, and their ability to adequately support waste disposal, the slope of the land, its effect on effluents, the availability of streams for disposal of effluents, and the applicable state and local health and water resources regulations, and F, which states will provide for adequate sewer waste disposal. And because section 15-2-6A, which states, that's a long one.
Paraphrase.
States that four test pits in the corner of all sites are a requirement under this ordinance to identify and locate the chamber systems or pit or leach fields. That section, the information submitted does not generally satisfy the standards, and section 15-2-7A, which states basically that in marginal soils, it is a requirement that the laundry systems, disposal areas are to be made a part of the plan, part of the soil disposal plan. And therefore, the planning board disapproves the preliminary subdivision plan of the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot subdivision proposed by the Greater Portland Development Group.
Motion has been made. Is there a second? It's moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Do you have the basic motion written down?
Yes.
For Alice, and then the tape will record. The tape is on. Any of the fill-ins for the sections. Does everyone understand the motion? Any further discussion of the motion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor of the motion to deny or disapprove the application for Highlands at Broad Cove, please raise your hand. Opposed? It's a 4-1 vote. The motion fails to deny. That leaves us back at ground zero. The Planning Board has made a motion to approve the subdivision and did not vote for that affirmatively. It's made a motion to deny the subdivision and did not vote affirmatively for that. What are the wishes of the Board? We have a pending subdivision application. Should we recess again and talk about, or is someone prepared to make a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Judith Kane.
Be it ordered that the Planning Board finds the applicant has generally met the standards contained in the subdivision ordinance and therefore approves the preliminary subdivision plan at the Highlands at Broad Cove. 20-lot subdivision proposed by the Greater Portland Development Group in accordance with Section 16-1-1, 16-2-4, and Article 3 of the subdivision ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. That all the lands proposed for Cable Elizabeth Land Trust ownership shall be accepted by Cable Elizabeth Land Trust and that written proof of said acceptance shall be provided prior to submission of the final plan.
Is this the same motion as before?
Some amendments.
Okay.
Can we accept the motion as it was made before and then just add the amendments?
Or are they throughout your motion or?
No. It's on one and one together.
Let me ask Mike. Mike, rather than reading a whole motion, is it?
I think it would be appropriate just to put forth the amendments to the previous motion. It's already on.
Okay. It is the previous motion to approve that you're making, Judith?
With
the amendments. Okay.
The amendment is in number 8. It's in letter E, which I'll read in its entirety. That all necessary legal documentation relating to any activities permitted or prohibited inside and outside the building envelope shall also be prepared by the applicant and deemed acceptable by the town attorney and the town planner prior to the submission of the final plan. These restrictions shall be placed in the final subdivision plan and within deeds of each of the proposed lots, the language of which shall be reviewed and deemed acceptable by the town attorney and the planning board prior to submission of the final plan, and that further these restrictions and covenants shall address specifically, among other items, drainage, lot use, grading, cutting, and any other uses which in the future would have any adverse effect on adjacent land or lot owners, or wetlands. The applicant may well include narrower building envelopes to assure landowners, subsequent landowners, that the drainage and fragile wetlands are perpetually protected.
Is that your motion?
That's my motion, and it goes on through I.
Does the Planning Board understand the motion? And as I understand, the motion is to approve the subdivision as was read before with the conditions, with the amendment that you've just made, which tightens up one of the restrictions.
Yes.
Does the applicant understand that motion? The board has waived the reading of the entire motion and that it stands as was previously proposed and has now been amended.
I second the amendment or accept the amendment, I guess, or whichever.
The motion has been made.
Yep.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for approval based on what was previously read with the amendment to condition E. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor, please raise your hand. All those opposed? It's a 4-1 vote with Mr. Edsel in opposition. There are other items.
Yes.
Wetlands alteration.
I'd like to make a motion. Find it. Be it ordered that the Planning Board finds the wetlands alteration proposed for the Highlands at Broad Cove project meet the criteria of Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance. Be it therefore ordered that the request of the Greater Portland Development Group for a Planning Board permit for wetlands alteration for the Highlands at Broad Cove, a 20-lot subdivision, be granted according to Section 19-3-9 of the zoning ordinance and the facts presented, subject to the following conditions. A, that the final wetlands boundary shall be field checked and determined by the town's wetlands consultants when said consultants determines that the weather conditions are adequate to perform a complete wetlands boundary field check. B, that any conditions attached to preliminary or final subdivision approval shall be applicable to this planning board permit. And C, that no construction or wetland alteration activity shall occur until after final subdivision approval is granted by the planning board.
It's been moved.
And
seconded. Any further discussion for alteration of wetland permit? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed?
I'm abstaining. Is that appropriate?
You should call for an abstention before the vote. A 4-1 vote, Mr. Edsel in opposition. There is an issue that I raised earlier for the Planning Board's consideration that if this proposal did pass, that there was a suggestion by one of the neighbors that an emergency access only road be approved. As I mentioned earlier, that is a town council activity under its traffic ordinances. And there is a motion drafted that would make a strong recommendation from the Planning Board that that the proposed Jordan Farm Road be signed emergency vehicle access only. The purpose of that is to remove the potential for through traffic flow down Hunts Point Road Extension, but that is a council decision. What are the considerations of the Planning Board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion.
Yes, ma'am.
Be it ordered that the Planning Board makes the following recommendations to the Town Council regarding the Highlands at Broad Cove and Jordan Farm Road, which will be submitted in writing to the Town Council only if final plan approval is obtained by the applicant from the Planning Board. A, that the Town Council accept Jordan Farm Road as a public street. B, that a 100 to 300 foot long portion of Jordan Farm Road south of its intersection with Hunts Point Road be signed in both directions to indicate that this section of the road shall be used for emergency vehicle access only prior to its acceptance by the Town Council for a one-year trial period. C, that the Town Council re-examine the appropriateness of the emergency access signage 1 year after the road has been accepted by the town and take any necessary action. And D, that construction vehicles be allowed to utilize Jordan Farm Road for construction related to the Highlands at Broad Cove lots.
It's been moved.
Second.
And seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. Yes, go ahead.
I just want to add, can I add one more?
Sure. If the proposer and the seconder agree to it.
Okay, they do. And that would be E, that the Planning Board strongly advise the Town Council in their reconsideration to consider the traffic and safety by making that an open road.
Have you reduced that to writing?
No.
Or did you get that else?
It's very inarticulate.
here it is. Does the board understand the motion?
No, I don't understand the motion. I don't understand the amendment to the motion.
Steve would like us to hold for a moment. I think he needs another tape. I'm running into a lot of tapes this evening. Judith, are you ready with your motion or with your suggested changes?
Town Council strongly advise all caution with respect to local traffic and safety in consideration of changing from an emergency access road to an open or full-time road.
Is that acceptable to the motions maker, Jen?
Yes.
Yeah, that's okay. Yeah.
Okay. You've heard the motion. Does everyone understand the motion? Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? 4-1 vote, Mr. Edsel in opposition. Okay, that concludes the votes that are necessary on Highlands at Broad Cove. You have preliminary plan approval. The process still requires final plan approval. And my understanding is the ordinance requires a submission and approval in a six-month time frame. Submission in a six-month time frame. Good evening. Goodbye. Next item on the agenda, Century 21 Balfour 295 Ocean House Road. Amendment of the site plan approval conditions, section 19.29. Good evening, Mr. Balfour. Welcome back.
Good evening. Still the same day as when I started here tonight. And I thank you for waiting. I'm here for a simple extension on the site plan approval that I received perhaps about 3 months ago on the dates for recording and the dates of completion of the improvements. And I'm here to answer any questions you may have.
Okay. Can you tell us, Scott, what happened to the submission process? Why didn't it get submitted?
Well, there's a couple of reasons. One is when we started the process, I had a verbal approval from a bank to construct this, and then they've received orders not to lend on this type of property. So there's some economic conditions that have happened. I had some troubles with some communications with the town picking up the approvals. Toward the end, there was a fire in Longfellow Square, which put my place of business out of business for 2 weeks in Portland. And then I found some hazardous waste oil tank on the site, which has now been removed. And so it's just
you've had a wonderful couple of months.
Bunch of circumstances.
Okay, so that the request is to extend the time for submission to the Cumberland County Register of Deeds and to extend the time for landscaping improvements and striping of your parking lot. the registry to May 31st and the landscaping and striping of the parking lot to August. What are the wishes of the board? Any further questions from Mr. Balfour? It's late. I skip over minor issues like that. Right. What are the wishes of the planning board?
To grant Mr. Balfour the relief requested. Mr. Chairman, I move that be it ordered that the planning board grants the request of Century 21 Balfour to make the following amendments to its January 16, 1990 site plan approvals conditions. A, that the date of completion for the landscaping improvements be changed from June 1, 1990 to August 1, 1990. That the date of completion for the painting of the striped lines delineating the approved parking spaces be changed from June 1, 1990 to August 1, 1990. And that the proposed declaration of conditions which were submitted with the applicant's materials for this planning board meeting be recorded by the applicant with the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds by May the 31st, 1990.
Motion has been made.
I second the motion.
And it's been seconded. Any further discussion? Hearing none, I'll call for a vote. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Opposed? Unanimous decision. You have your extension.
Aren't you glad you waited?
Good evening.
Make a motion, we adjourn.
That concludes the agenda. Motion has been made to adjourn.
I second the motion.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous vote. Let's go home. Mike, before you leave, I'd like to talk.